Thank you.
One piece of old business, just to cover, it got some feedback after last meeting, and I want to put into context. We spent probably an inordinate amount of time talking about the capital budget from a standpoint of how we receive the numbers from the stakeholders in the 5 year. And we spent time on it because in various management, it stuck out. And it wasn't intended to be actually discussed other than initially it asked Holly to put those numbers together, because I thought I'd see something different than we saw. I thought I'd see something that I saw 20 years ago. And when we looked at it, Holly then looked at it relative to the other counties surrounding us. So the issue was that we had sort of like a budget in year one, and then in year two it was like off the charts. And it's supposed to be a 5 year budget. So it isn't a big deal in terms of the health of the county or the county's going to tip over, but in good business process, I think the council's looked at the same thing. In terms of good business process, we want a more realistic 5 year budget, and so that there can be, and so whether we recommend it or not, that'll be an issue at the end. But it'll be a conversation.
The building went through, the last week, the building went through to start normalizing the out years.
Which is exactly what we're talking about. So we want it to be, that kind of conversation takes place between the county and the stakeholders. Because ultimately the stakeholders do what they think is best for their constituents. And some of us have been in those positions. So it has to be a meeting of the minds of how we can all work better. Okay? That being said, today we're going to talk to have the Howard County Public School System, the Howard Community College, and the Howard County Public Library, and they're going to talk about their budgets, both capital and to the extent operating, for the next fiscal year. And Beverly?
All the presentations today that they're handed out there, if you have a lot of time, pick up a copy. And also for last week's meeting and also future meetings, right after the meeting, we'll load all the presentation and the reference materials in the Dropbox. And you should all have already received the invitation. If you didn't, let me know. I'll make sure you get access to the Dropbox so you can access there directly as well.
And if anyone has problems getting into the Dropbox, my company won't let me get in. So that's, make sure you call Holly's office and we'll figure out how to get this stuff. Okay. Beverly?
Good morning. I'm Beverly Davis, Executive Director of Budget and Finance for Howard County Public Schools. I've shared three handouts at the back, so I'll just put there. One is the PowerPoint deck that we'll be going through. I'm going to try to follow Steve's recommendations and put that quickly so we can spend more time on substantive conversation about that. I brought with me today Bill Gallahue. He's our manager of planning for school construction. He'll be here to be able to field any questions related to our projections and the enrollment growth we're looking at, which drives a lot of the numbers we're going to talk about today on our budget. So I have the power deck. I've also shared separately the capital budget pages on a full sheet, so it's easier on the eyes. They're embedded within the PowerPoint, but I want them separately so it's easier for you to see. And I've excerpted a handful of pages from our operating budget that was presented last Thursday. The page numbers from the operating budget are at the bottom of each of these, so if you wanted to refer back to the operating budget document, I probably won't spend much time talking about this today, but I've just shared those. I've added the power deck and the schedules of the capital budget pages to the Dropbox already. The operating budget's a big document. It's available on our website. The board's capital budget is also available as a download on our the board's budget page website as well. So if anyone wanted to refer those, they can get to them rather easily. So I think with that, that gives a big Steve's intro is really sort of set the stage well for some of the work we've done at the schools in terms of looking at the long-range capital planning process we had for our capital budget. We formed a long-range master plan committee 2 years ago. That was the first year I was tasked with overseeing the capital budget. And at that time, all of the prior capital budgets had a somewhat reasonable first current year request, and the out years were just off the charts. I mean, it was, there were $60 million differences between the current year request and 1, 2, 3, 4 years out. And then looking at some of the projects in there, there had been a history of just pushing things forward and keeping them in there, but, you know, moving them through another year out, another year out. So we looked at it as a committee, and we had some stakeholders from the county government, the director of finance, and some folks from planning and zoning are on that committee. We had folks from curriculum and instruction at the Board of Ed, as well as folks from our own finance office and from school planning and school construction. And what we did is just took a fresh look at all of it and said, okay, let's look at, start with what's driving the need and how do we prioritize and look at it from the lens of what can be realistic. You know, having $150 million in our first year or second year out is not realistic. We're never going to get that from the county. That said, maybe we won't get to as low as the county may want, but we have to at least get it to something realistic and then be able to present and let the decision makers have some decision about priorities. Last year, the budget, the current year, we were able to do in FY16 a much better job of prioritizing what really has to be prioritized for this school system. And then this past summer, we really focused on the CIP and the long-range master plan. And if you look on the second page, the capital improvement program, FY 2018 to 2022, and I'll just talk totals here and then we'll jump through what's in the current year. FY 17's request was $105 million, FY 18 is $105 million, FY 19 is $99 million, FY 20 is $108.5 million, FY 21 is $116 million, FY 22 is $112 million. We really were able to normalize the request down to something more realistic. We shaved at least $40 million off almost every year, and it was based on looking at prioritizing first. And when we look at how it's prioritized, the first is capacity needs. To the extent that we need more seats for students, we have to have capacity projects in the budget first. Then it was the condition of schools. And we have a scoring system, and Joel may be able to speak to that, on the condition of all the schools. So in terms of prioritizing renovations, that was used to prioritize them. And then it was looking at the total. So if we, and saying we may have to move some out of here or two. So there was shifting outward on a number of projects, because as much as everyone would like them all done now, it's just not a realistic request. That said, you know, we recognize that it's a challenge. Funding is definitely a challenge. That's why this committee's work is so important for the county, because this committee can help the county set what is realistic, and then the board and the county can work through the decisions of what out of these requests, after we've done the work to say, here's where the needs are, which ones are we going to put first, and how are we going to stage the work after that. The other thing we did, if you look on the last page of the pages, at the bottom, in the past, particularly at the superintendent proposed stage, we don't have any of the information on the state's funding at that point. We at that point in September, we are submitting our priority list to the state, but the state has a very arduous process for determining what it will fund, and our match from the state is one of the lowest in the state, so we only get a 55% match on those projects that they deem eligible for their funding. So they don't, every project we do is not eligible for state funding. So we looked at our 10-year average of how much have we received historically from the state. And our 10-year average for in FY17 is 21.8 million. So then you say our potential county obligation is 83 out of our, looking at our current year, 83 million. Looking at the request, just, you know, trying to get some perspective on what it may be. At this point, we've received a little over 20 million in the first two rounds of the state's allocation since September. So we know we're going to get at least 20 million. Our request was 35 million this year when all was said and done, and we submitted. So we have the potential to receive another 10 million or so. We should know later this winter what that number is, and certainly by the time we're before the county council, we'll have our state numbers finalized to know what the delta is for the county.
Is there a historical percentage that you've been getting? So if you did in the past, if you've been asking for 35 every year, what's the norm?
So it's been, it has varied. I will say one of the school system has worked very hard to forge much stronger relationships with the interagency commission at the in construction at the state. So we have really, from being in maybe a decade ago, not nearly as successful at receiving our requests. Last year we received over 99% of our requests. So and I think that speaks to the fact that our school construction office works very hard to, one, make sure everything we request meets state requirements, that they are eligible for their funding. We provide all of the documentation. We, you know, do all of the work to make it as easy as possible for the state to say yes. And I do think it helps, absolutely, that our county is such a strong supporter of our capital budget. So, you know, we tout that every time we go before the state. Our Howard County taxpayers pay such a significant portion of our budget. And, so we're optimistic we'll get over 30 million in this year's request from the state. So that's the backdrop and sort of where we went in terms of trying to work on that. We are certainly partnering with the county in that effort to try to present a request that has been thoroughly vetted, looking at what the needs are. In recognizing it, then there are decisions that need to be made in terms of prioritizing them, because it's unlikely that all of them can move forward.
So the big comment is that they noticed, recognize what Beverly just said. We did notice that in this year's request of that year, especially for one of the non-con here, made some progress, because he's also doing the last year's, for example, some years request is as high as 140. $1 million. This was, as you can see, that amount of $110 million. So I think we hope that we could be probably they did make some progress without programming or planning on that. Having said that, we know that historically in recent years and based on fiscal condition, each year we only allocated 40 to 45 million from the county funding, because overall bond we have a ceiling on that, so these are still significantly higher than what we had. But to conquer with, she just said, the school size does have made some progress in terms of non-con. Thank you.
Okay, so we'll jump into just running through the card real quickly.
I'm sorry, a question on the process with the capital budget. Annual approval process, when you're in the planning stages and we say that, you know, we're doing a feasibility study, then we start to, we approve it, we go to a contract. At that point, we're building a new school. There is a multi-year commitment already in place, in essence. You're not going to stop building a constructive school. So as you look at these forecasts out in the future, it would be good to know what's physically committed. You can sort of figure that out by looking at some of the projects.
Sure,
each of those out years, how much is actually committed or encumbered, you know, from a capital perspective in each of those out years, we know. Before past the point of no return.
Certainly. Well, in general, and we can look at them in detail when we're on the pages, but in general, once the project moves to bid and the awards are made, the project's underway. And at that point, where there is some movement, it can be in terms of the amount of funding in any given year, which can either expedite or slow the construction based on the amount of funding available. So we've got a timeline for every project, we'll see that on each project. We have situations where, like for instance, at elementary school 42, where we have to expedite it because the enrollment growth is coming faster than we even expected. And so we need to get the school open a year earlier. We could alternatively have a situation where we say there's not enough funding, we need to, you know, we can only give X dollar, X million this year, which means the amount of construction has to match that. We have to be able to, basically, we don't have the authority to have the, we have to pay when they do the work, and if we don't have the authority, excuse me, authority for the funding, we can't have them doing the work. So we would be slowing the progression. There's some, there's cost to that because you're manning a project longer, particularly from the construction management standpoint. But overall, then it would be in the out years, you're either taking some projects, if you extend any in the current, you're taking projects in those out years and moving them out further. So it's,
so obviously
the ones that are underway are underway. But the flow of the money won't necessarily, and I'll be honest, it never matches what you see in the proposed. It changes. The only here it matches is the final approved. Every other one, there's reducing amounts on any given project here and there, and then, you know, moving others out and cutting a little bit. It happened. It's just sort of the process that
I understand that you're going to have some maneuverability in
yes.
the out years, plus or minus 10%, 15%, 20%.
Yes.
What would be good to see on a schedule like this is, you know, maybe down below, a subtotal of actual committed funds. They may slide from a quarter or a year, but, you know, what are those dollars that are already committed on the out-year forecast?
In terms of total?
Yeah.
I can look at putting a schedule together like that.
Not concerned about the individual
it's not
projects.
It won't match exactly, but any, like for instance, on that top page with the FY17,
yeah.
In the column that says codes,
yeah.
Any project that shows a C, that's construction phase. They're committed. So when you look at in the first six projects, they're all committed. We're in construction on those projects. They're all awarded. The new high school 13. That's a planning request. There's nothing committed there in current year or future year at this point. And then the others are rolling projects, and I guess we can just speak to some of that as we go. Any other general questions before we jump?
Yes.
Sure.
By the time the proposed budget comes down to the council, in the out years in the program, are you likely to put in your expected state funding, which we know is between $20 and $30 million in the request?
Well, so on the long range page and on the last page, we show our 10-year average. So in general, you can, from a general standpoint, you can subtract that 10-year average for an estimate.
Right. But
is really all it would be.
All right. I guess it goes to Holly, the question then. By the time it comes to the council,
okay.
Will it be including that proposed IAC funding that you believe you might get out in the program?
CD 54 approved that council. About a week ago, there was requested all the funding requests for future years also have a funding rate, which is most agency and county has already been doing there. I think the school system used to be, because as you said, cannot anticipate how much this was get from what we received from the state, but using, I think sounds like using historical average may be a good starting point to keep a placeholder unless you know something or anticipate something there. Or we can work with the school system to make that. Because
right.
Other counties have the same situation, but they all put their best guesstimate at this point
right.
for state or outside.
Right, it's just an estimate, but it will make it easier for looking at the bond funding and so forth.
Okay, so when we look at what some of the inputs into the process are, we have an annual feasibility study that presents the long-term capital planning and redistricting options. That information is factored into the plan, as well as the comprehensive maintenance plan. Again, that's from the facilities department and shows the condition of all the schools, helps us prioritize what needs to be completed. enrollment growth for Howard County is probably the most significant driver in our capital budget. We are continually growing. We're looking at over the next decade, growth of over 1,000 students a year. That's what we've been experiencing the last few years. And we've had, I don't know that there's been a year in the last 20 that the county hasn't grown. So the county is continuing to grow. I think we got a release yesterday from the state, and I know Holly shared on the Dropbox document that showed last year we were like fourth in growth at 1.6%, or the year before. This past year we were the fastest growing county in the state at 2.2% growth.
Does that track 1,000 a year? As I saw, didn't seem like there were 1,000. That was from the legislative services. Is that how it works?
This was, yes, 14, and then these are the projections through September. The 15 is not updated, but I think that's pretty darn close, because we didn't have our final numbers when we presented in September.
It's like take 100.
Yeah, it's within, it's, yeah. So that 53, we're within 100 students of what the actual was. Each year the enrollment is finalized in the, based on the September 30 enrollment numbers that go to the state. Yeah.
So my sort of question, maybe Joel or Andrew, since this is such a large driver of capital, I guess the question is, from the standpoint of the metrics or the projections for you, how comfortable in those projections are you in two ways? One is to absolute number, and in terms of where those numbers are coming from and why. Where's the analysis on that? So there's a logic to it, or is there no logic as to where people are coming from the county?
So you're asking, like, do we actually try to delve into why we have perhaps the higher growth rate than, say, adjacent counties?
It's not why, it's where. It's why and where. And so if you know numbers are coming in, it's where they're coming in as a starting point, so that you have an idea of going into 2-3 that they're going to be coming in the 2-1 card.
We project by school. So
and what's driving those projections?
It depends. In some areas we have very little new growth, but we are getting turnover of the neighborhoods. In other areas, the projection is being driven by a large number of future units that, like, for example, the racetrack, it's a large number of units that are driving projections for school. And then, some of them are projects that seem to be a little bit more in front of us. But we have to plan whether that racetrack project is built or not. We have to plan for it. That's something that we had a pretty good discussion about in the past. And I can go into more depth individually. I know you guys want to.
No. That's a good starting point.
Okay. Question, Steve. Can you characterize how well you've done your planning in the past 5 years or so? I mean, my concern is that
we do a study every
from the chief seats, there hasn't been a whole lot of redistricting, right? And I'm wondering, do we have schools that are overpopulated and ones that are wildly under?
We do every year analyze the accuracy of the projections, so you can at least get a sense as to how we stand up, and we provide some benchmarking against Montgomery County, so we can at least get a feel. Last year we got, from the state, we got some benchmarking showing, compared to the other LEAs, that they were able to look at over a period of time, we were best in class as far as projections. So I feel really comfortable that we have numbers that are guiding us in the right direction. So then the next question is, well, how are you planning accordingly? And if you look at the feasibility studies that we've done in the past 5 years, you'll see that we've definitely focused our attention on the areas that are identified in the general plan as being a priority for growth. I'm sorry, it's Jeff here, I can't remember the exact term, but the Route 1 corridor, the neighborhood centers, village centers, we've been making investments in Columbia in the Route 1 corridor, rather than previously, and there's good reasons for this, we were back on our heels in the west, so we made a lot of investment in those areas, and we ended up with capacity that we didn't need. There were a number of things that happened, the pervious surface, downzoning essentially happened. So I think we're positioned better in terms of what these capital budgets are focusing us on. If you look at the projects, you know, you can pretty quickly connect them to areas that are about to have new development and areas that have been turning over in terms of new families moving in.
I guess the question I just add on to Brian was, when you say you're best in class, what would be helpful for me, just as a business person looking at it, say, okay, what does that mean relative to percentage of correctness versus what you projected? And looking backwards 4 or 5 years, so you can sort of see that doesn't, good or bad, it's the reality. And I think our job is just, as overall county spending, but the whole issue of redistricting, which I know is a political issue for the school board as much as anything else, because it gets everybody upset. But when you're looking at cost of capital versus you have overcapacity versus a bus trip, if you will, and you're looking at cost versus learning, okay, in terms of where we spend our money, it's probably, it would be worthwhile to look at.
I'll provide that accuracy information like I did last year, but I didn't answer your question about redistricting. And so I guess your comment was, it doesn't seem like we've done a lot of redistricting. And what you have to remember is that we opened Duckett's Lane with after having done 2 full years of elementary redistricting. And that basically culminated with almost 10,000 students being moved at the elementary and middle school level. So that's quite a bit for the county to swallow. I mean, I'm not sure if any of you have been a part of having your student redistricted, but it's, every transition that a child goes through, be it 5th to 6th grade, 8th to 9th grade, or redistricting from one school to another in between, has some level of impact. And we try to bring resources to the table to make sure that child can adjust. But we would want to proceed with some level of caution. We wouldn't want to just make redistricting decisions so that a school opens up on the chart so the development can go forward. You would want to combine those concerns with a capital project so that we can bring the whole community together to have come to some agreement about redistricting. Otherwise, redistricting will fail, and we'll be in a worse position in terms of finding capacity. So I think it's important, the strategy of trying to tie redistricting to capital projects has been serving us over the past couple of years. So it maybe that's a marker of reasonably good planning, that we actually, good planning doesn't always lead to immediate action. And sometimes it's taking a period of time off to focus on other matters.
To be clear, I don't mean to suggest that we should do redistricting.
Thank you, Ryan.
I have kids in the school system. I'm really excited about that. My question is coming from the perspective of an accumulation of errors over a number of years. Do we have schools that are, if we're building a new school, have how much error is there? And we have one that's 60% overutilized and one that's 200% overutilized. Is there a balance there that we need to build a new school or is there room for some other alternative? Is all I'm trying to characterize.
Yeah. Well, the redistricting to open up Duckett's Lane, and if you look at the 2 years of elementary redistricting, did look at, something wrong with this, but did go towards trying to move boundaries so that we took advantage of some of the western capacity. It might have been able to go further, but if you go back to the meetings, you can see that there were clear discussions about how far is too far. So I consider that a valid process. So we wrung out as much as we could, and we built a school, and we opened it within 10 students of what it was designed for, what we had planned it to have that year. So I think that the enrollment projection served us, the redistricting process served us. The only part, as we went on the next couple of years,
No, it's fine.
Okay. As we went on a couple of years forward with Duckett's Lane, the numbers were coming in faster than we expected. And we responded. We moved regional programs out of that school. We don't have the pre-K programs there anymore. We moved them to schools where there was capacity. So we make the larger decisions in terms of putting the capital budget together that Holly had referenced, that we essentially cleaned up the long-term request. But we also make the strategic decisions. And I can introduce you to a couple pre-K teachers that will tell you they weren't too happy with that. But those are the kinds of things you have to do in order to make that decision. I saw him, but you know him. Go ahead.
Quick question. I'm just looking at the numbers. I noticed an awfully big jump in proposed county funding year over year, 17 to 16, with corresponding jump in expenses of 17 to 16. Is that already committed? You already know that $50 million county funding year over year change is coming? I'm on your revenue summary, general fund operating budget. Howard County funding.
You're an operating budget.
We're not talking about the
operating budget. Oh, I'm sorry. We haven't gotten there yet.
We haven't gotten there yet.
Sorry. Jumped the gun.
No. We're in capital.
Joe, first of all, thank you. Okay.
There's a maintenance effort.
Okay. This is the FY17 capital budget request. It totals $105 million. It includes a construction phase for Wild Lake Middle School Replacement School, Kentucky Valley Middle School Renovation, the Swanscombe Elementary School Renovation Addition, the Waverly Elementary School Renovation Addition, New Elementary School. New Elementary School 42 and Oakland Hills Middle School renovation. It also includes planning funds for new high school number 13. Other project requests include the systemic renovations detailed in the systemic project page, playground equipment, relocatable classrooms, technology, planning and design, and barrier free. We would go through each one of those in detail. Wild Lake Middle School was built in 1969. This is slotted as a replacement school. It's actually, at this point, back in September, it was, I think, at the bidding stage. It's almost under roof now across the site. And we actually have a webcam on the website, so you can click on it in real time, see the progress on the building. So
it'll be the first net zero energy school in the state.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's. The project adds 235 seats to the school, so it brings capacity to 760. So it's nearly twice as large as the existing school.
Just real quick, is that anticipating the downtown development part as part of that?
Yeah, it's definitely part of that.
Okay.
It will be, while it's twice as large, it's going to be more efficient and should, again, net zero. So at the end of the day, there'll be no cost to the running of the school from an energy standpoint. Again, we're in the construction phase, the total project. So each one of these slides are designed in the same way when you're looking at them and when you see them on your sheet. We show the year being built, the start date of the project, the completion date of the project, any additional capacity if it's a capacity project, the total cost. Then we show the phases of construction below it, and then the current year, the FY17 request. So the request on Wild Lake Middle School is $16.3 million. Patuxent Valley, built in 1989, it's in construction phase, started in 2013, slotted for completion in this August of 2017. The total cost is $29 million. It is current year request of $10.9 million. This would be a LEED certified school as well. Swan's
one quick question. Wildlake, the old school, we're tearing it down.
Yes.
Is that part of the construction?
Yes. Yes, that's part of the construction.
Yeah, the fields go where the old
buildings. Swansfield Elementary was built in 1972. That is in the bid currently. It's will be started. Construction should be starting soon. It's in planning stage. Completion for August of 2018. This adds capacity of 100 students for growth in that area. Total cost of 20, 5.9 million. The 2017 request is 12.7 million. Waverly Elementary School has a renovation and addition of capacity of 100 students. Total cost is 31.8 million. The FY17 budget request is 9.6 million.
Another question on renovations. I mean, in general, there's some that aren't additional capacity. In general, when you do renovations, are you looking at additional capacity? Or?
So additional capacity is based upon need. So that's really driven by the work that Joel does in the feasibility study to determine whether there's growth in that area needed.
I guess the question would be that sounds like logically that would fit in your priority process of making the decision.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Like Tucson Valley is no additional capacity. It's just getting it up to speed.
So. Yeah, certainly it'll make it a lot more usable because it had some smaller classrooms, so they had built this temporary, like, they actually took a bunch of portable classrooms and connected them together, and it was not the best strategy. So making the building function better, it'll essentially have better use of the capacity. It's a good place for it.
Right. I mean, I guess in general, when you look at renovations, you know, what the initial capacity, how much capacity.
Yes. And we start out with how they're going to phase the construction project, because sometimes, you know, having a swing space will help the project, and it also can help later on as capacity in the area. So we kind of balance those two decisions when we budget the project.
Beverly.
Yes.
I'm sorry. The 13.3 million, is that including the planning funds? Because at the bottom you have an asterisk saying that it's coming out of a systemic renovation project, but is that included in the full amount? Do you transfer it back over?
Which one are you on?
You were looking at Waverly?
No, we were looking at Tucson Valley.
Oh, I'm sorry.
At Waverly,
we were. Okay, I thought we were looking at Waverly, sorry. They were, but they went back.
And that's a good question. I can't remember because we have some projects, great question, but we have some projects that the planning phase is funded in systemic. It's predominantly renovations. So renovations, sometimes the planning funds will start in systemic, and then we separate the project, say this is a discrete project now, we separate it and ask for the funding in as its own line item in the budget. They're detailed, so even on the systemic, you can see any project that is slotted. So it's not that it's not transparent. You can see any project, but I'll verify that. Not correct.
Okay.
You guys?
Yeah, this is just for, I guess, general information for me. In terms of, I guess, looking at just the overall school construction cost, particularly when there's a new school, whether that's, I guess, replacement or totally brand new school, is there kind of a, I guess, kind of for as an example, elementary, a middle, a, I guess you could say, general price tag, so to speak, that you just say this school is going to cost X, and then, you know, for high school it's going to cost, you know, Y or what have you. And what I'm using from my mind as an example, I'm from Georgia. I've been here for a year, and I recall the school system where I grew up, they built one year three new high schools in different parts of the county. And as an example, if you go in any one of those three high schools, they basically, if you've been in Tri-Cities, you've been in Roswell, you've been in Creekside, they basically literally all have pretty much the same footprint, which obviously was one way that I presume they were looking at controlling costs and so forth. So just from my, just, I guess, education in terms of generally speaking, we look at cost of building, is there generally kind of a price tag that we normally say an elementary school generally is going to cost X?
Not the cost, it's the design. We have prototypes at each level, which feed the instructional program, and that's approved through a process with educational specifications at each level that the board approves, and then a prototype design is created to do that, and they, then that is the basic model. There may be some variations in that based on site, you know, whether something has to be relocated or whatever, but to save cost, and yet to make sure that it's meeting, you know, program need, then that's how those are applied.
Yeah, so when we look at elementary, the board has the approved prototype is a 600-seat elementary school. The board has also, when needed, approved a prototype at a 788, a larger. So Veterans Elementary is one of the 788 prototypes. New Elementary School 42 originally was going to be in the board-approved prototype at the 600 based on the enrollment projections. We came back to the board and requested approval to go with the 788 prototype so that we would have the additional capacity for the expected growth. In terms of the cost then, again, so the design is board approved and we're going with the prototypes that they approve. If you go to Reservoir and you go to Marriott's Ridge, they're pretty much the same school on a different site. If you go back 10, 15 years, there are going to be differences. And 20, the older schools, there are going to be differences. Got to go faster? Okay.
Well, it's not you. We're all asking the questions. It'll be about 10 minutes so we can get you in.
I can skip the project by project detail if you'd like. Let's go to the capital improvement. If you want to look at the capital improvement. So we talked about the total request in FY17 at $105 million, and again that we've gone through New Elementary School 42, and then was the slot in the first year slot in for completion in 18. Oakland Mills Middle School is a renovation that was slotted in. It's in construction phase, $9.1 million in 19. New High School 13 is slotted for 2023. But actually, that one has see for the first page 17. I'm sorry. That is much further out, but it's we're asking for planning money now because we're looking at a new model for regional high school, and it takes planning money to determine the educational specifications and how that would be structured for the county. So then when we look at the out years in 2018 to 2022, this is our work to prioritize the projects. When we look at all the way through New Elementary School, New High School 13, if 17 moves forward, these projects are all underway. The new request in 2018 would be Hammond High School renovation, and then it would be slotted to start. And on the CIP, it's a little easier to see, at least for that five-year clip, but particularly if the project will be completed in that time. The to the far right, the five-year CIP total for any given project. The systemic renovations line, you'll see, is a significant line, and again, this goes back to Craig's comment when you, so if you jump to, to the systemic page, which is the next page, these are predominantly the renovations, or the maintenance, you know, the renovations, some small, some larger. So for instance, if it's just a HVAC or a boiler or rooftop units, it's a much smaller renovation. Those are actually discrete items that the state will participate in funding. So that's why you'll see them broken out in that way, and the state has a schedule of timeline for when those become eligible for funding. Those are evaluated for condition by the facilities department, and they're prioritizing the ones that are, one, eligible for state funding, and two, are in the most need of replacement. And we've really pushed them to say, if it can go another year, and so they're looking at that cost benefit of, can we make it last longer, and maybe we'll have some repair, but that cost of repair is lower than replacing it now and putting that capital expenditure out? Or are we at risk of a large repairs in order to keep, because these are things that they have to be working in the school. If a boiler goes up, we're going to have an emergency replacement, or if a rooftop unit goes up. So that's
emergency funds.
Pardon me?
Emergency fund comes from where?
We would be prioritizing it within systemic.
Can you move stuff?
Yeah, come on, other system.
Yeah.
I'm assuming, yeah, the CapEx budget, which is a heavy screen, which is smaller stuff.
Yes.
You're probably those numbers around first.
Yeah, so if you look at the other systemic at the bottom, the 6.7 million across, that's really where whatever's coming up as the most important critical that year that has to be done. Yeah, that's what that is for.
So that's a true emergency fund?
It could be viewed in that way.
There's some operating funds.
Yeah. So if, yeah.
I mean, you would expect, I'm just saying, from the accounting side of business, you have a budget that anticipates, you don't know exactly, but there's going to be costs that come up in operating the building, that you've got to have budgeted for a certain amount, whether it's used or that's like snow.
Yeah, reasonable.
They said.
This was.
So, we have those types of components in the systemic. We also have.
Beverly.
Also, that's the systemic. Long range master plan goes through 2026. And I think this is where you'll see where we're staging the out years for the enrollment growth that we spoke to in the beginning. We've got Oakland Mills, we have New Elementary School 42 underway now, but we have New Elementary School 43 beginning in 2020. We have New Elementary School 44 out in 2024 beginning. Yeah, so you'll see the out years.
Do you maintain kind of like an average age of our plants, and how do we compare our school system to other school systems that we may benchmark against? And that might give us some sense of whether or not we're renovating more quickly or not as quickly as other systems.
We'll send a page.
Yeah.
Yeah, that
would
be
the
human
center of the hall. That's a good question.
Anecdotally, Howard County schools are the best school facilities in the state. And there is, and I think this is what we'll flesh out over the course of the budget discussions each year. And, you know, I think it's going to go with right now, at this stage, taxpayers want their schools, and they advocate strongly for their schools. If they're in an older school, they want it renovated, and they want it renovated now. And they're advocating heavily to their county council members. We get scolded last year. I mean, we were literally, you know, we get scolded if we deferred a renovation. They literally, a council member will, in this group will say, why are you asking for so much money? They're like, why didn't you ask for this right now? Our people need this right now. I mean, that's the conversation. So the expectation is from the community at this point is we want our schools well maintained, and if it's older, we want it renovated to be as nice as the newer ones. When taxes go up, that might change. Taxpayers might say, our school, you know,
well, everything is always great when we have to pay for it.
Yeah, so that our schools are, when you go through them, and I know we go on tours at the beginning of the school year with first day of school with all the elected officials. If you haven't had a chance to walk through any of our schools, I encourage you to. They're beautifully maintained. When you go to other counties, they don't compare.
We do have a school that's not celebrated its 90th birthday this year. It has been in continuous operation for 90 years.
Which school is that?
West Frontier.
And it's been renovated.
Yeah, but it's going to continue.
This is last question.
In the, out through 2026, or the land acquisition site, I mean, do we have all those sites?
No, we're still in the process of acquiring some important sites for some of those schools.
And your site acquisition is the $2 million on?
Yeah.
That's construction reserve.
Yeah.
Can I get that budget?
What'd you say, Bruce?
Yeah, it's interesting. My site acquisition's like this and my construction's like this, so it's interesting.
It's all zoning.
I know.
Well, there's actually still money in the reserve.
Okay. Beverly did a great job on the budget.
If you could give us a site, that would be.
Oh, here you are. Lynn will be really good because I wore my Howard Community College muffler.
Yeah, we'll change that. Well, I'll put that time to put out the PowerPoint for Lynn and send that link for the presentation. Just to reemphasize some points that we discussed earlier about the picture, that as we just talked about the schools, request for future years, the Amazon here shows progress from what they had last time. For the group that was here last month, you see that the future years project, the request was 3.7 times the current actual versus other counties there for the school system, all lower than current year. So now with this change there, it's only like 3 times of actual. Upcoming. So that is a progress, but still, I guess that's a long way to what the reality is, because last year, as you know, the county had 96 million GO bonds, of which 61% support education entities, of which 35 million was for the school system, which together with the transfer tax is $43.7 million here, and that's typical for historical level between $40 to $45 million county funding. It's not likely to change much in the next several years here. So the current request is between $100 to $120 million, which is already scaled back from the local discussion for future years here. But still a couple of times what the reality of the county funding will likely to be based on the existing funding structure on that. So as Beverly was alluded, that there are a lot of kind of priorities you have to going on, dialogue has to going on, because you know there needs and requests, which is, we don't question that here, but that's also reality check based on taxpayers money. That's the funding constraint we have to work on, and we also have the, for the stewardship of this committee, we also have the bonding, general obligation bond limitation that we have to be conscientious about, and that burden for our individual taxpayers.
Will you discuss operating budget?
If we have time right now, because the operating budget, which is question, starting point
51.7.
The reality of this, we'll try to come back to it. The reality of this committee is we will recommend an overall, okay, an overall increase in the budget based on the revenues and such, without relative to the specific stakeholders. You know, we'll try to, we have the operating budget in without, but right now we need to get on capital, which is going to be a time to come
back. And just to beat the CIB horse one more time, the 2018 commitment, if you will, and I know there's some flexibility. I mean, we've already committed $65 million in 18 by approving the 17 capital project. Again, some of those things could slide. We could take the first 5 or 6 projects, and assuming the new high school 13 moves forward, we've got about $65 million that's slated for 18.
But 17 hasn't been approved yet.
17 hasn't been approved yet.
Assuming 17 is approved, then you said it, you're committing to $65 million in 18.
But we know it.
So, which is a larger discussion we get in at the end. That's the whole discussion about which we're making progress in reality versus what you're asking for, understanding that stakeholders, such as the school system and the college, work under a system that's been going on for a long time. So moving it to a more realistic has implications not only within the county, but when they're rolled in the state. So it's not a simple answer to this, but we're trying to make this progress towards more realistic approach to the state.
And also, since we don't have time to talk about off-peak budget on the side on that, there, look at the handout and look at the drop-off that we already wrote back on the overall budget request from superintendent. We also have some reference flyers that showing the county's comparison to other counties in terms of contribution. You see, we pretty much have number one, number two among other counties there. But these, we are reading interest after this meeting, we don't want to take too much time from community college.
I just wanted to know the $50 million increase. I think that's going to be, I mean, that's a major concern, I guess.
Oh, yeah.
And it's obviously, if we're going to fund that, it's going to require, if the county's going to fund that, then our recommendation would need to be there for unprecedented tax increase, you know, all that. I'm trying to figure.
Well, I mean, you make it to that level.
That's my, exactly, and that's one of my questions.
There are a whole bunch of things, so there's no question. But that's a council and a county executive. I'm going to say a question. That's their issue. Our issue is, it's our house, okay? We got revenues, we have expenses, we have priorities. From the standpoint of our house, what do we think is appropriate to spend? The politics of whether it's a council or the executive and all those other things should not enter into this room. Our room is to give our best recommendation to what is realistic and makes sense. And then, you know, as I said in the first thing, I told my wife, I don't care who likes me, it doesn't matter, okay? And this is like, we have a house, we have the metrics of that house in terms of what we make, what we earn, and what things we want to do and choices we make, and the relativity of that. This is not whether it's a school system or the college or anything. This isn't a committee set up to get into what's the best way to spend the money or what's, because I can talk and you can have drinks about how we move the numbers in terms of results, not spending, but results. How do we move those numbers? What are the best ways to get? That would be a great discussion. I love it because I've spent 12 years on the college and I'm very passionate about those things, but not in this room. Okay? That's an easy take, isn't it?
My presentation's a little bit different because I do talk a little bit about our operating budget first and then I get to the capital. So I'll move forward from there. Just to give you a little background. Okay. 24% of all of our students come from the Howard County Public Schools, so as the Howard County Public Schools grow, so does the college. And also, out of the Maryland Higher Education Commission, 44% of all county residents who are in undergraduate higher education are at the community college. So that just sort of gives you a sense of how our population grows. Our student household income, the majority of students are under 100,000, and when you break that down a little bit further, you can see a large percentage, about 29%, have incomes under 20,000, and they are on Pell or other subsidies. Over the last 15 years, we have grown about 82% in headcount. In our credit area and our non-credit area has grown about 20%, and our winter term, which recently closed, was up about 5.7%, and spring is tracking up about 5.2%. When you look at the growth over the last 10 years, the Maryland Higher Education Commission had actually done does a chart every year, but you can see how fast we have grown compared to the other community colleges. The average across the state in growth for that period of time is about 17.7, but we've grown about 51%. So that's part of what's driving things in our budget. Unfortunately, you look at the funding that we get from the state for our operating budget, we are at the bottom of the list in that funding because of the fact that we have grown so rapidly and the state has not always been able to fund the formula that's put in place, which is called CAID. Looking projections going forward, we're supposed to grow about 34%. These come from the Maryland Higher Education Commission. This is just in the credit area, so you can get a sense of what we're looking for in the future. And then when we look at our operating budget, slide, it's on your handout. There is a handout.
So the actual.
So I'm not sure why that came up this way. But at any rate, the majority of our funds come from student tuition, and then the county is about 27% with the state at 14%. So I know on your handout it should have printed out properly. The tuition and fees, when you look at that, we're the best bang for your buck in the state, so as far as Howard County is concerned, and when you're looking at UMBC, it's about $11,000 a year versus our $4,600 a year. And the operating budget, obviously, the majority of it is personnel, 76%, so that has a driving factor in where you move forward. The operating budget for FY17, our biggest request is going to be opening the SET building, which will open in the spring of 2017. We have partial year costs in there for the year, so that's really the $900,000 is about a half year worth of the cost, and that's one of the big factors that will be driving our operating requests for 17. The other piece is MHEC, which is the Maryland Higher Education Commission, has a guideline for faculty of a 50-50 ratio. Our ratio is 38-62 full-time, 38% full-time faculty, and that's a big piece that we, because we have grown so fast, we haven't been able to add the faculty that we need. So every year we ask for a few faculty positions so we can try to match that growth. Our adjunct faculty pay, I'll get to in a minute, but that is lower than it should be when we look at statewide averages. And then obviously we would have our merit increase. And I would like to point out the community college does not fund COLA. We only give merit increases based on performance, and that's been a standing
thing. I take responsibility for that.
Yes, you have a lot to do with that. and also, obviously, ongoing contract increase. Our adjunct pay rates are really not what we would like them to be. When we look at our competitors around the state, we actually have a partnership in Laurel with Prince George's. The other schools are paying more for their adjunct faculty, and that's been a big issue with us because we have had faculty leave and go to CCB, in Baltimore County, and Prince George's because of the fact that they can get a lot more money. So that has been an issue with our budget that every year we try to add to. And I'm just talking about the capital budget. Basically, when we look at the statewide averages, because of our growth, our current space deficit is about 183,000 square feet. And this is with the SET building that's under construction coming online. And in 10 years out, it's going to be about 300,000 square feet. So we are funded 50% from the state, 50% from the county. The state will not give money if the county does not match it. And one of the things that we have done, we had done last year, because Holly had suggested that, we did go back and look at our capital funding because we had, for example, the nursing building renovation was supposed to start this year. Holly asked us to move that out, and and in the future years, what we actually did with all of our capital projects, we moved them back at least 6 or 7 years after our discussion. So we moved that back significantly. But the science, for the FY17 request, the science and engineering building, as this came up before, we only have 50% will come from the county and 50% from the state, but that construction has already been committed. That building has started. I guess we can always stop. And this was really something the state started. They wanted to phase in funding for all the community colleges, and so they asked us to break it out this way. But they have pre-approved this project to fund, but of course we still need county funding for that. Our systemic renovations, that's a lot of in-house renovations that we have, and it's things like our track hasn't been resurfaced in 15 years. We have an HVAC issue that we need to really replace the Hickory Ridge units and things of that nature. So there's a long laundry list of things that we have in systemic that we're requesting as well. I mentioned that Holly had asked us last year in our discussions, we moved the nursing and ST bed building renovations at, because when we move into the science and engineering building, that building that they're in is going to be vacant. And so we need to renovate that space because it has a lot of labs and they're converted into classrooms. And then finally, our parking garage, what you will see on here, we are actually funding the garage partially with, well, the county's paying about $2.6 million. We took our fund balance to pay $6 million of it, and then we're asking the county to float CC bonds, but it wouldn't be part of the debt limit, and we would pay those bonds back. And so we've done that.
Is that our student fees?
Yeah, the student fees, and that's what we've done on one other garage, well, actually, two other garages we did that, and also the quarter of the Harwich Center, we actually are using student fees.
Originally, the gallery.
Yeah, the gallery, but that's been paid off.
Yeah.
That's how we funded that. But the state right now will not pay for parking unless that's your only project. So, and we really are shuttling students from
the state. How about renovations?
They pay for renovations, so they have 50-50 on the renovations. There are a couple of things in the renovations they didn't want to pay for, but they've already reviewed our project.
Showing that state in the systematic.
In systemic, they don't pay for systemic things like resurfacing your track or HVAC units. They won't pay for that, but they will pay. When we renovate a major building, they would pay 50% of that.
So if it's not a building, you're on your own? Or the county?
Yes.
Well, if it's not a building, it would be, and it sounds like it would fall into what we would normally call gas tax, depending on the number of budgets that I'm paying for that. Josh?
Tuition and fees, what's been the trend line on tuition growth in the last 10 years, and do you have a projection on what it looks like over the next 5-10 years?
Well, basically, we've tried to keep within inflation, so it has gone up 2-3% each year. There was a period of time we had no tuition increase, and so then we had to catch up with that. So, but it has been about 2-3% each year we've taken tuition.
And the state aid, is that formulaic, or?
The state aid, it's called the CAID formula. 60% is based on your school's enrollment growth, and 40% is a fixed fee, but it's actually based on what the University of Maryland gets the year before. So they take all the growth for all the community colleges, put it in a pot, and allocate it out based on what 60% of your growth is, and 40% a small fixed amount from the prior.
And Josh, typically, I don't know what they believe does now, but typically when there was an increase in tuition, they built into the increase in tuition a piece of it that was really going to scholarship to help fund the unmet need of the increase for the those of you.
And then the CAFL faculty numbers, is faculty teaching faculty, or is it?
The adjunct faculty are part-time faculty.
No, but I'm saying the term faculty, are we talking, is it all just, when you say faculty, is it teaching faculty, or is it also administrative?
Oh, no, it's all teaching faculty. Okay.
Steve,
was your question about annual tuition increases or yeah. Total pot growing of tuition because of enrollment?
Annual tuition increases.
The systemic renovations, is that likely to be bond fundable, or are we talking PAYGO, $4.2 million in 2017?
Some of it could be PAYGO, I mean, because it is, you know, ongoing, but it, most of it is, normally has been funded by the bonds.
Are there any increase or decrease for out-of-county or international students?
There's a funding formula that we have to put in place. It's statutory by the state, and basically whatever your county pays, we have to increase that. So, for example, our in-county students right now are paying like $132 per credit hour. Out-of-county students are paying $218 a credit hour, and out-of-state students, because then you put the state money in, they're paying $260 a credit hour. So it is increasing based on the funding that you get from your local entities. And they actually, an out-of-state student would pay the full freight of what it would cost to be at the institution.
Thank you. Back to the question about systemic renovations. You had mentioned that the roadways and parking, those are funded by CC bonds, which we don't have to account for in the overall bond. I'm assuming the systemic ones you talked about it being funded by bonds, those would be ones we would have to consider.
Yes.
They talk about.
And I would like to point out, among the community colleges, we are one of the only one where our students are actually paying debt service, because that's, we agreed because of the garage to do that. The Harwood Center, we agreed to do that too. And as Steve said, we have about $800,000 in our operating budget for scholarships that we give out every year to needy students who really can't afford that.
Great place to donate money.
Gotcha.
Okay, and then I just at the, this is our master plan. I had mentioned that we had moved a lot of the projects in the future away out. So the next building that we're anticipating coming online is not until our math building, and that was moved out till 2020, so it's, you know, further down the pipe. And all of these are way in the future, so we have to update that every 5 years. And then just some misinformation about the return on investments for our school, for the college, about 19% of their tuition. They get a return on their investment. We earn additional money over the years and what they would earn for median income, along with how much we put into the local.
Liz, you're terrific. Valerie?
About our curriculum, but I wanted to begin with an introduction that just says everything in our operating and capital aligns with our strategic plan, which you have our Vision 2020, which is our new one. Thank you all, by the way, for participating in our community leadership breakfast last year, those of you that did. So here's that plan, our operating aligns with that. And our capital projects align with our master plan. And so that is what I'll be presenting to you today. So the ability for this committee to make sound decisions based on investments, we need to understand what the operating is funding, what the capital is funding, and what the need is. And so with Howard County Library System, it is the funding that we receive for both the operating and the capital that enable us to deliver extraordinary education for customers of all ages. Our customer base is all ages. It is infants through pre-K, K through 12, we work very closely with the school system and the community college, and then all of the adults. We, like the school system and the community college, are governed by a board of trustees, the Maryland Annotated Code, the Article of Education, Maryland State Department of Education, and also clearly the county. We have 6 branches currently. We just opened the administrative branch, which enables now the capital projects to continue for the East Columbia and the Central Branch space that we just exited, and you'll see that when I get to the capital projects. Not on here is a new Southwest branch, and so that too will be on the capital project. I do have a summary sheet, and we'll get to that in a minute. So for operating, we have a board meeting next week to finalize the operating request for FY17. What I have here is the amount that we had for FY16, which is $21.7 million. And I will begin by saying that this represents less than 2% of the county's overall budget. So the point there is we are a small investment for a truly major return. 87% of our funds come from the county, 4% from the Maryland State Department of Education, and then 9% is Howard County Library System generated. We also include grants there for our operating budget. How do we spend that money? Almost 50% goes towards instruction, 19% for customer service, and 14% goes for our curriculum. Herein lies the mystery for some of you. So what is our curriculum? We deliver
equal opportunity in education for literally everyone here in Howard County. And we do this by compartmentalizing what we do into three pillars. The first one is self-directed education. That includes anything our experts can make available to you, the customer, whatever your age, for you to find on your own. 7.3 million items loaned last year. That is the highest borrowing per capita in the state, among the highest in the country. 3 million visits to our six branches last year. So the self-directed education pillar includes 1.2 million items. Most of those are print books. About 7% represent e-content at this point. It includes live streaming. It includes Tumble books for children. It includes music and video and audio books. New for children this year is the Launch Pad. It's virtually indestructible for ages 3 to 10, apps that can be used for educational purposes. Specialized online research tools include Morningstar and ValueLine for sound investment strategies, PressReader, 4,000 newspapers, this is new this year, same day papers from Shanghai, from Sydney, from Paris, it's really phenomenal. Online classes is extraordinarily popular these last couple of years. Gale courses and new last year, lynda.com. Practice test, SAT, LSAT, GRE, math for grades 5 and 6, you name it, all kinds of practiced exams, all available for free to the customer. World languages includes Mango and Pronunciator, 45 languages for Mango, 80 for Pronunciator, and we do have some paper print books in our world languages collection. Beanstack and NextReads, this is what we push out to you if you express an interest, for instance, in business and personal finance. You can get an email every month. You click on unfinished business, you might want that book, and you see we have it available in e-content, in print, and in audio, and you can just reserve it right there. So it's a convenience for you all. That's what we're all about now, convenience for the customer. We have 400 public access computers system-wide, and we just made our website user-friendly on your app. Our second pillar, research assistance and instruction. Personalized research assistance for you, for your children. Classes that we teach for students of all ages. Here, 2 million research assistance interactions last year. And I want to tell you about our class and event attendance. This is actually something that is quite notable. 306,000 in attendance. This is the highest attendance in Maryland, not per capita. And here's why. Infants through pre-K, some examples of our classes include Baby Sign. We teach the foundations of reading, subject matters including math and science through children's literature, social skills, creative skills. We have music, great composers. We have What's in My Art Box. This is Jackson Pollock. We take Jackson Pollock outside. Down on the farm, Twist and Shout, our county executive audited this class last fall. For K through 12, A-plus partners in education, we have an A-plus curriculum. We work very closely with all of the schools. We have an A-plus educator card. We launched this in 2002. Kindergarten Here We Come, 1,500 kindergartners come to our branches every August to learn about the first day of school. They practice boarding a school bus. Little Brandon didn't want to get on there, but this minimizes the tears the first day of school. Same thing for moving up to middle school. They learn about the locker combinations, backpack, what to braces, what to learn, what they will experience. Kindergarten field trips to the library are part of the school's curriculum. We have teen time and homework club at our East Columbia branch for after-school academic assistance. We teach STEM courses, including everyday engineering, chemistry in the library, and high tech. Our STEM education initiative for teens, you have the technology of fashion, quad rotors, hovercrafts, music and audio mashups, 3D animation, and we design, engineer, and launch a weather balloon each summer. Adult basic education, 400 students each year. This is three prongs. One is one-on-one tutoring for English. One is studying and taking the U.S. citizenship test, and the third one is
the GED, and here you have some of our graduates, we have a graduation every year. We strive to maximize our revenues, and we launched, we can handle your passport application at our East Columbia and Glenwood branches. So this is an assistance to you. We conduct research on your behalf if necessary, and it generates revenue. We're creative with the Enchanted Garden, now your teaching venue, your sunflowers, and Professor Fibonacci. Let's plant a rainbow, and just for wondrous enjoyment year-round. And lastly, our third pillar is instructive and enlightening experiences. This is partnerships. It's bringing the community together to discuss and experience ideas. Children's Discovery Fair at the East Columbia Branch, summer reading kickoff, 5,200 in attendance last year for Batman. Crocodile encounters at our Central Branch. Every year we hold the Bumblebee for grades 1 through 3. It's a precursor to the Spelling Bee for grades 4 through 8. ACLS Chess Tournament. For STEM education, the Rube Goldberg Challenge every year. This year, the assignment for the kids is to design a wild and crazy contraption that ultimately erases a blackboard. Battle of the Books, 40% of all fifth grade students now participate in Battle of the Books. They read 16 books over 4 months, take a 50-question exam on a Friday night, thinking it is absolutely fun. They dream up a team name, like Pickerels, Page-Turning Penguins, dress the part, show up on a Friday night, 6,000 people, the reach is about 30,000 when you look at the families. Reluctant readers turn into avid readers go for gold. We give out best team name, best team spirit, best costume, and of course, best score. Well and Wise, our partnership with the hospital, we partner with EDA, with the Arts Council, with CA. Choosability is a continued initiative that involves all ages. For adults, we have any number of events. This is featuring Dr. Neil Barnard, Power Foods for the Brain. Evening in the Stacks is a community event each year. This year it will be Black by Susan Ball, so we hope you all can come to that. Here we come to our capital projects. I have the summary of our capital projects for you. This was our Savage Branch and STEM Education Center that opened. This is rolling off the sheet, but this is our latest one. 3,000 people attended our grand opening. Here are two shots of the East Columbia Branch and the Central Branch. Remember, I mentioned the administrative branch that we just opened? We just freed up 9,000 square feet of space at our East Columbia Branch for a teen wing. We will have a teen-up center, a student design center, a place for high-tech classrooms. We'll have space for a much larger meeting room that we need there for the events and classes that we teach for all ages. At the Central Branch, we have freed up some 7,000 square feet of space to improve on, well, we'll be able to triple the space for project literacy, eliminate wait lists for students there, and also add a high-tech classroom. The new Elbridge Branch, well, it's actually a renovation of the current building, greatly expanded. That goes from, well, this is the aerial view from Route 1 and from the parking lot here. You'll see just the space. It also includes 10,000 square feet for the senior center, co-located. But what we'll be able to do with twice the space here is double the size of the collection. We'll add 50% more computers. We have currently no quiet study rooms, and so we'll be able to add 6 group and quiet study rooms. The conference center, community center, the meeting room space and classroom space will triple. We'll have a multi-purpose classroom. The curriculum focus on this branch will be DIY education. We'll have a high-tech classroom, there'll be a cafe, a new business center, and the design center component, a student design center. We'll have the messier classes here because it'll be a multi-purpose classroom for crafts. And so pinatas, for instance, and duct tape. We'll clearly teach these classes System 1, but this will be our headquarters for it. For adults, we'll have It's a Fine Line, Caulking 101, how to put up wallpaper, or why not to put up wallpaper. But just, this, we'll have STEM education here too, but this DIY education component will be the focus.
Spending affordability.
We anticipate a groundbreaking of spring 2016. We need to close the branch then in May. Construction is anticipated in June to conclude then in December of 2017. Don't have any images of the new Southwest branch because that is still a figment of our imagination and anticipation. But we do have some funding. We have $8.2 million requested for FY17, and $277,000 is targeted for a feasibility study to see where we might put a branch in the Southwest. We continue to get requests from that segment of the county, and to see where that might go. That is the intent for that.
What's considered Southwest Howard County?
Well, Clarksville, that area, Highlands.
So Highland, Fulton, Clarksville.
Yes, somewhere in there. It will all be determined. We'll need to figure out where this branch might go. The cost of the land might be what's available. And so it's part of our master plan to have it there. There's requests for you.
DIY curriculum, is that books, or are you also going to have like power tools?
Well, it includes a number of things.
Because I think power tools would be awesome for a library to have, because use them once a year or twice a year.
Did I know you could check out power tools or something?
So, first one, it's just
you could get a circular saw.
I would put a $500 table saw.
So is this what you do with your spare time now, Josh?
I would. You have to have a license to get that power saw.
Well, the concept is a DIY collection. The concept is a DIY collection, and then DIY classes, and then also potentially events. But the collection itself will comprise small tools, yes. So instance, if you have a project for the weekend and you need a hit, let's say you're downsizing. Let's say you're at a stage in your life where you are now in a smaller venue. You're given away, sold. Actually, people say we have all these tools we'd like to give them to you, so we'll be able to use some of those. So you don't have the tools, or maybe you're 20-something and you still haven't purchased your collection. Or maybe you just don't have the tools. So you borrow the hedge trimmer and the weed whacker and the hammer. Let's say you're doing some projects over the weekend. You borrow all of those. You learn how to use the weed whacker if you've never used it before from a class that we might teach on that safety of it. And then you borrow those for the weekend, return them. So there's that portion.
With the whole harness and gun.
Absolutely. That is absolutely true. You have to be a certain age, and for some of the tools, you will have needed to have taken a safety class using. We have that on.
Yeah, I think that's awesome.
Yeah. It is.
But it's also intended to be craft tools and bicycle repair kits. So then to be able to teach the class on wallpapering and then the tools that you need for it, you can borrow it, use it. And we hope to partner with the Home Depot and Lowe's to actually teach some of these classes and have that be part of the focus there. Yes.
You mentioned the senior center, right? Is that you said it's co-located?
Co-located.
Separate building?
Well, we'll share a wall. Actually,
is it in your capital or is it in somebody else's capital?
It's in this project. Okay. It includes it in there. If you see the wall, the high window, right there, this is the senior center side. Senior center side. This is the library. So this is the wall that we share. There's a door that goes into the cafe from the inside. This allows really beautiful sunlight to come in and flood the library side, so it doesn't really feel like the wall is all dark in the barrier. So this provides a lens, if you will, just symbolically throughout the building. And then this is the old building right here. Those are, if you remember, the skylights there.
You've done an incredible job of downsizing your presentation into a very effective one.
So I'm glad you think so, but I do appreciate your indulgence, because truly, many people still believe that libraries are just a warehouse for books. We are an active education center. that really has a balance of those three pillars that I mentioned. And so to fund $8.2 million in capital, you need to understand what that is funding and why we need the space.
Okay, we're going to get you out here in 2 minutes. For next meeting, we're going to have, Larry's going to do a discussion with EPA, Department of Water Works, our great friends in the room. Stormwater, who I talked about last week, and important for us to understand stormwater remediation, what's going on in the county, how, you know, there's been a lot of talk. I just want Jim Gardner, who's really good, to be able to give us some background on that. In terms of, and especially so we understand it in terms of what's bondable and what isn't, relative to time, length of project to bond, if that's something that they would use their fees or income out of their hourly funding for that. Police chief will be here. Fire will be pushed off because he has a conflict. And if we have some time, we'll try to allow Beverly some time for some discussion of the operating budgets as we squeeze that out. So we'll try to do that too. Okay? Stuff will go into the Dropbox. If you have any questions or feel like you need any information that you think is important to as we process this, you can email me or call me or Holly, and we'll try to do that. We want to be respectful of our time, but we'll try to do that and put that into the Dropbox. Again, if anyone has any problem using the Dropbox, please let us know so we find another way to get the information to you. So next week will be an important meeting, and then we take a week off.
Just a quick thought here, really, on something Ryan was mentioning, kind of a preview to the operating budget discussion. I did a quick scan, and it seems that the biggest driver of the spike is fixed charges.
Yes.
Is there a breakdown sheet that shows the composition of that line? And if not, could there be one for our discussion?
Yes.
Thank you. The other, okay, have a great week, and we'll see you next
Richard, we met last week. I'm going to give you a piece of paper. You can't go anywhere without getting a